Okay.
Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Nice to have you on board today. I'm going to weigh in today on the school shooter. In fact, on 95% of all school shooters, the left has galvanized itself to suggest that we should have an Australian type of gun control. Did they really look at the law? It was not a gun control. It was a gun confiscation. Every single gun in the country was confiscated, and if you left any part of a gun or bullets out of a confiscation, you could go to jail. Now think about this. Mao Zedong had gun confiscation. Hitler did. Stalin did. And exactly how'd that work out for its citizens? Nope. It's not the guns that should receive the focus. It is the medications they were on. Dr. Charles Gant, an MD, PhD, will be on today talking about the nature of pharmaceuticals and what it can do to your perception. Plus, we have several historical references we'll share with you. Also today, we're going to go to our audio file, and if you watch or download the program from Facebook, you can then later in the day see the actual video clips. For our purposes, when it's live, you can only hear them. But we're going to take you on a couple journeys, not that long, relatively short, but I want to show you three factors. One, we're going to talk about how the Monsanto weed killer is used in, it's in everyone's blood. And could it be killing people? An independent investigation, we'll talk about that. And why millennials are fed up with capitalism. And then how about the poor in America? Who's speaking on their behalf? How do they actually live? We're going to look at that. And we'll get to as many of these as we can. But we always begin with the latest on health and nutrition. That's something that benefits everyone listening. There has been some controversy about taking calcium supplementation or vitamin D, that it could be associated with a heart attack. University of Southampton did an exhaustive study and found that it simply, there is no association between the use of calcium or vitamin D and cardiovascular events. And this was published in the Journal of Bone and Mineral Research. So that's just another myth you can put to rest. People find comfort listening to the same songs over and over again. I'm sure as I do. You've heard a song 1,000 times. You know the lyrics. You know everything about it. But you still want to hear it. And according to the University of Michigan, that is not uncommon. With the frequency that some people play their favorite song, it's a good thing vinyl records aren't used often because they'd wear out. University of Michigan researchers have found that people enjoy replaying a favorite song many times, even after the novelty and surprise are gone. And what this means is that among the sample people they tested, that people listened to some music hundreds of times over the years, and what it was, they had a deep connection to the song, something that was particularly likely to connect them with their emotions, even bittersweet emotions. Now think of how many transitions we've made in our life. Think of going to a doo-wop, and I love to go to the doo-wop and go to hear some of the older acts, like Hall & Oates. And even if they can't hit the notes as they once could, it's still fine because you're replaying a moment in time that was special. And we're going to have many special moments in our lives. There's a lot of transitions. Music brings us back to that moment and allows us to feel at a deeper level. So keep listening all you want. Now, here's something else I found. and I haven't seen any independent research on this, but I've gotten enough feedback that I know it's true. I've written a lot of books on health. They've been very popular. But one of the most important books I ever wrote was Finding Joy. It was not a huge book, but it was just common sense about what we're doing wrong and what we should correct in order to find joy in the things that we do every day, instead of just going through mindless rituals and repetition. Bring joy into the equation. It can change your perception of the moment you're in. I did also the Baby Boomer's Guide to Getting It Right the Second Time Around, and Be Happy Now. And my latest book on that was all about touching the spiritual within all your deeds and actions, meaning if you start off with the idea to do something good, don't be distracted by anger, revenge, pain, trying to bring karma to someone who's abused you. You don't have to bring anything. Forgiveness is best. And that was the meaning of that whole book. Again, it was not a big book. But I've had more people tell me that they've read certain chapters 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 times, because each time they do, another mystery is revealed, meaning something else that wasn't apparent the first time they read it becomes more apparent. And for myself, I've gone back to read Montaigne and Nietzsche, and I'm a voracious reader, so I've read a lot. And each time I read it, I see if there's something new that I can understand, or even how I can change my perception, because our filters block the true intent of learning and growing and surrendering old knowledge to gain new perspective. So don't feel that because you've read something, give it away or throw it away. No, go back and reread it if it was something that you found important to begin with. From the University of Kiel in Germany, you want to help prevent gallstones? Eat more foods that are rich in vitamin E. Or, of course, you could take vitamin E. In fact, vitamin E does everything from ease exercise soreness to treating premenstrual pain to preventing cancer and playing a role in neurological and cardiovascular function. I suggest 4 to 800 units a day. I do not believe you can get enough vitamin E from the food. In fact, I know you can't. But you can certainly take a 400 milligram or 400 unit supplement of the mix to tocopherols. That's why you're getting the alpha, the gamma, the delta, the beta to tocopherols. And that, according to the research, can help prevent gallstones, which are very painful. From the University of Southern California, published in Pediatric Obesity, vitamin D, if you're deficient in it, and most people are, during pregnancy, can program genetically obesity in your children. So if you're pregnant, it's simple and inexpensive to get a vitamin D assay. And if you're deficient, bring yourself up to what your body requires, and that can help prevent obesity further on in your child. Now, along that same line, from Georgia Regents University, a study on a high-fat, that's your typical American diet, prompts your immune cells to start eating connections between neurons. Now, this is important because when a high-fat diet causes us to become obese, it also appears to prompt normally bustling immune cells in our brain to become sedentary and start consuming the connections between our neurons. And that can lead to early dementia. So, one more reason why you should be very conscientious of your weight and the amount of calories going in. And by the way, there was published in Brain Behavior and Immunity. So if you're on a plant-based diet, you're not going to have a high-fat diet. But the fats you do have will be healthy fats. And from Korean University in South Korea, could blackberries, just a powder of blackberries, could, or black raspberries, either one, Could they improve your blood pressure and help support your heart and cardiovascular system? An 8-week supplementation of a high dose of extract from the powders, the berry powders, said yes. It can help lower your blood pressure. This was published in Nutrition. So the takeaway message is simple. Eat a cup, which is not a lot, of blackberries and black raspberries, and help bring down your blood pressure and help protect your heart. From the University of Nebraska, children who take ADHD medications, and there's a bunch, have trouble sleeping. Why? Simple. These are stimulant medications, and they cause sleep problems among the children who take them. And then you have a child waking up in the morning, and they're not fully rested. Their immune system will be impaired, their blood sugar will not be even, and they'll be more hyper. So just one of the things that we're now finding out. And if you want to protect your skin from within, there's a 24-week program that I was reviewing from Seoul National University that was just simply a high flavanol cacao supplementation, like a chocolate, each day, and it impacted facial wrinkles and skin elasticity in photo-aged Korean women. So that's important. It was published in Journal of Nutrition. So if you're having trouble with your skin, having 2 ounces a day of a healthy chocolate bar could help with your skin, help reduce the sun's damage, and that's critical. And also, a lot of people are now becoming more aware of autoimmune conditions and why they're so prevalent and why Western medicine does nothing to help them. So what can you do to help yourself? One of the best things you can do is realize you might be having autoimmune triggered by leaky gut. And a leaky gut allows partially digested food particles and proteins and pathogens and toxic bacteria to make their way into your bloodstream, which causes an immune response because, oh my goodness, the entire immune system suddenly puts a 5-alarm fire saying, we've got invaders. And then your whole immune system galvanizes to go in there and start destroying these invaders. And every time you eat, you're going to redo this until your immune system is exhausted. If you have bloating, food sensitivities, thyroid conditions, digestive disturbances, fatigue, joint pain accompanying leaky gut syndrome, then you know you got to work on your gut. And to work on the gut, it's not that difficult. I've helped a lot of people overcome leaky gut. You got to go vegan. Lots of juices, especially green juices, are important. And then focus upon probiotics 3 times a day, cabbage juice 3 times a day, vitamin C in buffered form 3 times a day. That can make all the difference in the world. From our environmental segment, high levels of microplastics found in the Northwest Atlantic's fish. This is from the National University of Ireland. It talks about this new study finding, 73% of the fish in the Northwest Atlantic have high levels of these plastics. So you eat the fish, you eat the plastics. And these are not big pieces of plastic. These are microplastics. So this study sheds light on the magnitude of microplastic pollution in our oceans. So there's 3 ways of dealing with this. And this was published in Frontiers in Marine Science. They found these microplastics in the stomachs of nearly 3 out of 4 of the fish caught in the Atlantic, North Atlantic. So don't eat the fish. That would be the smartest thing to do. And also to join one of the campaigns to try to clean up our oceans. That would be good. And then to collect all the articles on how fish are being polluted and sea turtles and mammals of every type, sea lions, and pass that along because it will make a difference, at least for those who are open to having to make a difference. Also, and finally from our environmental segment, According to Scientific America, one of the most respected publications on the planet, our ozone layer is still declining, meaning the lower stratosphere's ozone continues to decrease despite the world's success in phasing out ozone-depleting chemicals. Back, according to this article, back in 1985, scientists reported something very unsettling. They had found a hole in the planet's ozone layer above Antarctica. And the culprits, they said, were humans emitting chemicals that depleted atmospheric ozone above the South Pole and the rest of the globe. And because the ozone layer protects us and other organisms from harmful solar radiation, the international community united in 1987 to sign the Montreal Protocol, which phased out the use of such chemicals. And the protocol, widely considered a huge success, which it was, since its enactment, significantly dropped the level of some of the most common depleting chemicals in the atmosphere. And the hole over Antarctica has been shrinking. Yet, in a new study published in Atmospheric Chemistry and Physics, scientists now report, as of today, that one crucial section of the ozone layer still seems to be declining steadily. Now, the ozone layer resides in the stratosphere. Just a little tutorial here. The region of atmosphere from 10 to 50 kilometers above the Earth's surface. And this blanket of gas is vital for life on Earth. It absorbs the sun's ultraviolet radiation, which can damage DNA and also promote skin cancer and other harm to humans, wildlife, and crops. In reality, ozone is distributed throughout the lower, middle, and upper stratosphere, as well as in the what is called troposphere, and the atmosphere's bottom layer that extends up from Earth's surface to about 10 kilometers, or around 6 miles. And thanks to the protocol from the late 1990s on, ozone in the stratosphere is locked like it wasn't going down anymore, which is a massive success. But then it was found to be doing so. And keep in mind where the United States has had different refrigerant materials and air conditioners and freons, other countries in the world like China and India and Brazil didn't adhere to the same standards. So now we now see that it is declining, meaning that the ozone hole is opening back up again. That is not good. Because when that happens, it means that when the sun goes through that hole and hits your skin, it's going to burn it very fast, in seconds. If it hits plants, it'll shrivel them, destroy them. Animals, it would burn them as well. So we better pay attention to this now and immediately deal with this, because it takes a long time to stop this. And we need to all be on the same page. We all need to be working together. That's the latest on health, healing, and the environment. We're going to take a break and come right back. Please stay with us. I'd like to welcome all of you. I'm Gary Null. We're going to now go to a segment just showing what happens when people no longer are able to sustain a life. In effect, they're made homeless. How do they live? Where do they go? How do they get there? How do they get out of there? Why aren't we doing anything as a federal, state, or local community to help them? I took my camera crew, and I went into an area in New Jersey. This was just the first of places I went. Oh, by the way, this summer, the exact dates I don't know. I'm fixing up an RV so I can broadcast and film as an editing studio. And I'm going on the road, going all across the United States. I can't tell you the nature of the filming I'm doing at this time, but some people ask, could they come along? And 10 years ago, no, it's longer, 15 years ago, we had a bunch of people from our running and walking club who got on bikes, and we went clear up to Wyoming, Montana, and the bike clear down into New Mexico and then flew back to New York. It was a wonderful experience. So if you're athletic and you're interested in spending 2 or 3 weeks on the road, learning about life that you wouldn't otherwise know, and we use one of the RVs for cooking and showering, and otherwise we're on the road and then every day filming and learning and listening. You can simply send your background and your state of health. I don't want someone who's sick coming, because then it's all about how everybody has to deal with that sickness. I want healthy people for this, because it's very vigorous. I mean, it's long days, it's fun, it's enjoyable, but you really have to be in shape for this. I don't want to put someone in a position not to enjoy it. Go to prnstudio@gmail.com, prnstudio@gmail.com. And while I'm on that, before I go to this audio clip, I came up with an idea recently. I'm going to hire someone for a period of time, whether it's a month, 2 months, or 3 months. I don't know how long it's going to take to do. But over the past 6 years, I closed down my film studio where I had my film archive on East 92nd Street and 2nd Avenue. And I moved some 4,000 square feet of films that I've shot and lectures. And now I'm going to go through all of my films and films I've never released, lectures I've never released, and I'm going to archive them and then going to stream them on the internet. And if I interviewed someone who was particularly interesting, but I only used a minute of them in a film, but there's an hour interview, I'm going to stream the whole hour. So it's a way of having thousands of people on very important topics that we all would benefit from. And you just go to YouTube and under Gary Null, and there they'll all be. So if that interests you, you can send your resume and background to, this is a paying job, by the way, but it's not in New York. It'll be in Florida. Send it to prnstudio@gmail.com. I'll select one person for that project. Now, let's go to a homeless camp and see what this is about.
Across the street from a rally for people who are here to talk about homelessness and what it means to be poor in America today. It would seem that none of the policies of this administration are stopping home foreclosures, are giving loans to small businesses, are helping to lower the interest rates on student loans and debit cards and credit cards, some of which are 59% interest. It seems just business as usual. Let's speak with the individuals. We're in McPherson Square in Washington, D.C., just a couple blocks from the White House. As you can see, there's an encampment here. People from around the United States are protesting.
I was studying to be a public school teacher. I'm not sure whether I can continue pursuing that degree, although my passion is education, and it's something I'll commit to. And I'm the mother of 2 4-year-olds, and so that's my job.
I'm a public school teacher. I stopped teaching a year and a half ago.
The community overall has been wonderful. It's a sense of true family. We have travelers, we have professionals, we have disenfranchised people of all sorts. We have very privileged people of all sorts, and we've all come together here and tried to drop that privilege, to drop all of our pretenses, and to make a real community. And I think we've succeeded phenomenally well.
We are all here, in a sense, poor. We're living in tents. We're eating communal food that's donated to us. We wear clothes that people donate to us. So we're all poor. And And even if we have jobs and even if we are part of a larger society, we're coming here because we believe that together we're strong. And in order to do that, in order to build this intentional community, one of the keys is to like embrace the sameness of everyone. And everyone is the same, so we're not trying to like make distinctions between who can be here, who can't be here, different qualities of wealth. Like we're all the 99%. There's the metaphor is true here. We're all like in it together. When we march and when we get together and plan things in solidarity, and we confront some of the outside forces that we're here to confront, I haven't had any fear. This movement is a way to draw attention to the plight of people who have been struggling with like material lack for a really, really long time because of so much material wealth. And the choice to shed that wealth, the choice to get rid of it, knowing that your accumulation of wealth means that someone else is lacking, the choice to get even for real, as an intention, as a political statement, as a way to draw attention to people who have been living like this.
I'm here to promote campaign finance reform. And I think that's the core problem with our democracy today. And as soon as we figure that out, we can start moving on to healthy legislation that'll start improving the lives of Americans in the United States.
I would encourage
this is part one. It's in two parts. The first part is in Washington, D.C., in a little speck of land, maybe a half of an acre. You had almost 100 people camping. There is a political statement. Now, these were not homeless people. These were not poor people. They were merely there in a symbolic gesture to see what it would be like if they had to eat donated food, what they had to live like if they're living in little pup tents with no electricity, no toilets, no running water. And I commend them for doing that because at least they tried to put themselves in the shoes of those who have absolutely nothing. And they were there also as a political statement to try to get America together to say there's something wrong when we have 240 million Americans who are poor and no legislation, no effort is being made to house them, to feed them, to help them. So good for them. Now here's part two of real people who are poor, living in the woods, and this is their journey.
About a year ago, I received a call from a friend who said, "Are you aware of how many homeless vets are living in Florida?" Was that there were no electricity, no sanitation, no food, no stores, no place to get anything, and yet they were surviving. I was told there's a place in New Jersey, not far from New York, an hour and a half away, that's not too dissimilar than what you were discussing about the plight of the homeless vets in Florida. So we just arrived. We're only 100 yards off the main road, a very affluent area here. And here we see what is clearly an encampment of people who are trying to survive. We're going to talk with them in a moment, and we're going to go into some of these homes. There's a tent there that's up on logs. You have I passed a teepee, a lean-to, and I'm told that there are over 60 families that live here. This is not legal, and I don't see electricity or septic systems, so I'm going to ask them the same questions. How do you get through a day? And why is it they have no advocates? We're in the state of New Jersey. Why isn't this an issue? Homelessness in New Jersey. Now, what's interesting is just briefly, I spoke with some individuals who were college graduates, including professionals who had earned six figures a year and now living in a homeless camp. They're doing the best they can. And I'm told, and now we're going to get the details, that the county doesn't want them here, the city doesn't want them here, their neighbors don't want them here, the state doesn't want them here. All right. Well, what's the state doing? to stop the foreclosures, and to help them? These are questions that I believe should be answered. Were we living a very high standard of life, and now it's collapsing? Not only has it collapsed for the 5 million who've lost their homes, it is collapsing for another 6.8 million people in the next few years whose mortgages are underwater, and a total of about 11 total million over the next 6 years. So let's just project ahead. Within the next 6 years, we could have over 50 million homeless Americans. And not a single thing can I find the Republicans or Democrats are doing to stop home foreclosures, to help the people instead of the banks, to put them out of their houses, to feed the 17 million hungry children, to provide living wages instead of McDonald's wages. Let's explore this in depth.
I've been working with the homeless for 11 years. For the first 5 years, I worked with a high voltage electrical contractor doing a lot of government work and Port Authority work. I've worked in the Holland Lincoln Tunnel and all the bridges, Port Authority bridges and airports. And at the same time, I was coming home and helping out the homeless. It was about 6 years ago, or about 5 years ago now, that I realized I couldn't do both. I couldn't do the secular job working in the city and come home and adequately supply the homeless. So I quit the job working for the high voltage electrical contractor and concentrated on just helping out the homeless of Ocean County who they don't have access to any type of shelter.
Why not?
There's nothing.
There's no shelter.
There's no shelter in Ocean
County.
In the whole county.
How many people live in Ocean County?
Oh, it's at least half a million. Yeah.
And a half million in New Jersey, in a rather affluent area, you don't have a single shelter?
Not a single shelter.
That's insane. Yeah. Now, I understand the county and the state and others don't want you here.
Right. You know, to this point, they've been trying to push out the homeless, sweep us under the rug, and just try to ignore the problem. But, you know, of course, with the economic situation the way it is, more people are falling through the cracks. More people are having no other options but tent city. So the tent cities are growing. The politicians can't help but take notice, and they realize that the general public is starting to notice that there's homeless people living in the woods of their county. So they're starting to realize that they can't ignore the problem anymore. There's 15 platforms right now in the camp, and it was the township of Lakewood that forced us to demolish.
Why?
15. We signed a consent order last July that we wouldn't expand the camp. Come late fall, I realized we didn't have enough structures to house the wood stoves to keep the people warm during the wintertime, so we had to break the consent order and build the structures to keep the people warm. We built them, we survived the winter, nobody got sick, nobody got frostbite or pneumonia. But just a couple of weeks ago, the township said tear down the structures. But we're looking at another winter around the bend, and it's gonna be life-threatening. To this point, the state has never come down into this camp saying, what can we do to help?
State doesn't help you, the county wants you out, the local township wants you out. What about the neighbors?
We have no problem with the local neighbors, never had a problem with the local neighbors, being affected by this camp in any way. And so, yeah, I think they're supportive. Some of the buildings in the area are projects or poor people themselves, and they can understand, how people can end up here.
We've had a lot of rain in the last few days, so there are mosquitoes everywhere. And you see plastic, which protects them from the rain and offers some insulation from the cold. And you see this like a little trailer here with mosquito netting. And you see 55-gallon drums around that are burning wood. And I'm assuming that represents some form of cooking for them.
We came from New York City, from Queens. Jamaica Estates. We lived in an apartment there for 11 years. How we got here? I'm sure you know there's a lot of bad business practice in this country. My wife was a top textile designer in New York. For example, Robert Allen Company, which existed for 30 years, she had four of the top 10 selling designs. Her designs were in Target and Lowe's and Kmart, million-dollar designs, and her boss paid her less than pennies on the dollar. Not only did he pay her less than pennies on the dollar, he and his cronies would sit around and schmooze and chew the fat and do nothing, and they were jealous of her productivity and creativity, so he wound up firing her. We had a totally full-time schedule. I've been writing a book on veganism, doing radio work with BAI. When my wife lost her job, we were had no place to turn. We lived with our daughter's family for a while, and we had a falling out. My wife was speaking to a friend who said the very same thing, that there were many homeless encampments around. She said, why don't you try that? My wife went on the internet, and the very first one that came up was this one, Minister Steve. She called them, said, you know, told them about our situation, we would want to come out, said we had birds and everything, and he said, fine. And a month later, we came here to live. One thing about this camp, there's a lot of donations here, which is great, you know, for people in need. So with all the support that people get out here, people are very cooperative. They're understanding that in order for us to live in any sort of a healthful way, we can't be unsanitary. We have to respect each other and respect ourselves, you know, so we keep pretty clean.
There's much more to that interview. You can download it from YouTube and watch all of it to see all the different people, including professors who are there homeless and all trying to respect each other's dignity. And they are getting some donations from local people who are poor, know what it's like to be poor. And wouldn't you guess that the poorest of the people are giving the even people poorer than them some of their food and clothing. And that's how they're able to survive. Now the town has closed down the camp completely, came in with bulldozers, and so they've had to move to different places. So they've been spread all over the place. But if the idea of paying someone to get on a Greyhound bus or paying for their ticket, not giving them money, and then sending them someplace, that's how people in San Francisco and Los Angeles deal with homelessness. It doesn't change the circumstance of the person. We need a national referendum on once and for all helping those who cannot help themselves. And we don't need someone's spiteful and maligning attitude and all their rhetorical backsmack that these people somehow deserved it because they're lazy, unmotivated, or cheats. They're not. The people I've met have been very decent human beings. And that's why I've allowed over the decades hundreds of homeless people in my own living environments until they could get back on their feet. And so as a nation, we have let them down. And that's just this first part of this story. You're going to be hearing from homeless people I interviewed in California, in Texas, Mississippi, Alabama, West Virginia. You're going to hear a lot more in this series. We'll do a little bit each week. But before we go to our guest in a moment, let's go over and say hello to Luann Panessi. Hi, Luann.
Hello, Gary. Yeah, I'm here because I've been interviewing people for our upcoming retreat, and we are just about full, but we're still interviewing. So if people are interested in coming down, it's going to be the second and third week of April, and it takes place in Texas. And if you want more information, please give me a call. My number is 903-881-7008. That's 903-881-7008.
That's not why I called. Why I called, it's all right to mention it, but by the way, BAI has earned about $15,000. Just that'll pay for almost 2,000 premiums, I'm happy to say. So it's a big infusion for them. Why I called was this. I began to realize yesterday after I spoke with Guy McPherson, a man who I have great faith in his integrity, but also he's looking at all the pieces to climate change, not just a few. And there are a handful of people who look at all of them and saying that we are not going to have a world that's going to be sustainable the way we're going and being negligent. So it's now time to begin to interview people who would like to make a change in their life, who are at that place in their life where they're looking not when the disaster is upon them, but before there is anything that goes wrong, of how they can become more empowered, safer, better places to live, and be able to do what they couldn't do alone, having the synergy of other people help them with their projects, the what is called the intentional living environment. So if people are interested in this concept, they should give you a call. Could you give me your number again?
Surely. It's 903-881-7008. Again, 903-881-7008.
Good. And that's the beginning of the interview process, to try to find people who have projects that they want to work on, focus on, but also maintain their own sense of autonomy, independence, but share some things in common in a sustainable environment that will not be impacted as other places in the United States would be. Thank you, Luann.
Okay.
Now let's go over and say hello to my guest standing by, Dr. Charles Gant, G-A-N-T, M.D., Ph.D., and he is a person who's very concerned about the medications that many children are receiving, and he is an author and teacher and, most of all, a practitioner who provides innovative and personal care for his patients. And Charles has practiced functional and integrative medicine and mindfulness-based cognitive psychotherapy for almost 40 years, and he's with us now. Nice to have you with us today.
Thank you very much for having me on the show today.
I began to research the association, whether it was causal, casual, or non-existent, between the psychiatric medications people were taking and those same individuals committing acts of violence that, according to their parents, they had never previously seen in those same children. And I just want to, before you answer me, I'd just like to go to this one statement here that I'm going to read to you. It says, before the late 1980s, mass shootings and acts of senseless violence were relatively unheard of. Prozac, the most well-known SSRI, selective serotonin reuptake inhibitor, antidepressant, was not yet on the market. When Prozac did arrive, it was marketed as a panacea for depression, which resulted in huge profits for its manufacturer, Eli Lilly. Of course, other drug companies had to create their own cash cow and followed suit with marketing their own SSRI antidepressants. Subsequently, mass shootings and other violent incidents started to be reported. More often than not, the common denominator was that the shooters were on an antidepressant or withdrawing from one. This is not about an isolated incident or two, but numerous shootings. The question is, during the past 20 years, is the use of antidepressants here a coincidence or a causation? There have been too many mass shootings for it just to be a coincidence. Eric Harris and Dylan Klebold killed 12 students and a teacher at Columbine High School. Eric was on Luvox, an antidepressant. The Virginia Tech shooter killed 32 people, and he was on an antidepressant. And while withdrawing from Prozac, Kip Kingle murdered his mother and stepmother. Then he shot 22 classmates and killed two. Jason Hoffman wounded 5 at his high school while he was on Effexor, also an antidepressant. James Holmes opened fire in a Colorado movie theater this past summer and killed 12 people and wounded 58. He was under the care of a psychiatrist, but no information has been released on what drugs he may have been on. Psychiatrists generally will tell you that these people were mentally ill and they weren't treated in time or didn't get enough help to prevent the tragedy. However, Dr. Peter Bregan, who is a psychiatrist, stated that depression rarely leads to violence, and it's only since the SSRIs came on the market that such mass shootings have taken place. So could you give us your insights on what you have found is the association between taking the medications or withdrawing from them and what it does to our perception and that could lead a person to violence against others or themselves?
Well, what I do is, through functional medicine and genomics, is I look for the underlying root causes, toxic causes, toxicity causes, immunological causes like Lyme, nutritional deficiencies, inability to make the neurotransmitters, gut dysfunction, and so forth, and the genetic. We look at neurotransmitter genes that allow you to make the neurotransmitters or genes that allow, receptor genes that allow them to work. So we have this broken down pretty well now, especially in the genomic age. We know why depression, all the common mental disorders, we can see their biochemical roots. We can test for them and reverse them. So the use of psychotropic medication, except for acute psychotic episodes, generally speaking, is obsolete. It's obsolete because we simply have a much better technology to address these kinds of problems. So putting a toxic substance in the brain is relatively obsolete and can be very harmful. It can disinhibit the executive function.
Impacting a person's perceptions. We'll get to that after he speaks.
Can you hear me okay now?
Sure can. Please continue.
Okay. So I have the regular sound. So yes, basically we have this executive function that looks at the choices and their consequences. It's the prefrontal cortex and associated structures. And we know from PET scan studies, neuroimagery, that all psychotropic toxins have a major impact on this executive function, and people lose an ability to see the consequences of what they're doing or what they're planning to do. So unquestionably there is a disinhibition and the adverse effect on this most important part of our neurological hardware, our frontal lobes, that simply people can't see what an impulsive behavior is going to do because they can't see the consequences of it. So with those who are vulnerable biochemically from heavy metals or nutritionally, like essential fatty acid deficiencies, or they could have Lyme disease or neurological Lyme, some infection, they got gut dysfunction, any number of risk factors that would complicate this whole neurological or neuropsychiatric problems, which are at the cause of psychiatric disorders. When those factors are in place, plus who knows, a person could have post-traumatic stress disorder or been abused. There could be any number of things. When you throw chemical at them, that's the psychiatric approach. You throw chemical at somebody, the consequences are totally unpredictable. And the black box warnings on antidepressants, especially in young people, are there to as proof of that.
So several years ago, I interviewed a Mormon family in Utah. The son had been having a little difficulty in a relationship, as a lot of teenagers do. And otherwise, he was an exemplary student. He was a top athlete in football and basketball. He was a high-grade student. He was very well-mannered. And so his father, to help him, put him on some antidepressant. The next thing, after taking the antidepressant, the kid woke up, he was in jail. And he said, where am I at? Why am I here? Well, you've been arrested because you took a gun to class and threatened to kill the students in class. And you didn't kill anyone, but you're here. And he had to go through a long trial, and his family had a lot of difficulty trying to show that he was completely normal until he had the medication, because so many other psychiatrists in the area were opposed to trying to align the idea that maybe it was the meds he was on. And yet that's the only thing that he changed, and he had a horrible time getting off the meds, as many people do. It's not an easy process. It's not just walk away from it.
Withdrawal could be, from SSRI can be very, very unpleasant. We provide people 5-hydroxytryptophan, the precursor for serotonin, that greatly modifies the withdrawal symptoms. But you Eli Lilly, you know, they knew, yes. They had trials as far back as 1984, before the drug was approved in 1988, that indicated that this kind of agitation, anxiety, and violent behavior was possible. And I forget, I think it was in the postal trial where a guy goes, they call it going postal. In that trial, I forget when that was, but it was, you know, some years later, the judge could not get they couldn't get their hands on the earlier trials. Eli Lilly hid it in the courtroom because they did not want to suffer from the embarrassment and from the legal consequences of very, very violent activity that happened as a result of taking Prozac. And it's not just Prozac, it's all the SSRIs, actually.
Since January 1, in less than 2 months, in the United States, we've had 18 school shootings. 18. And we're not looking at all of them. If you go back to January 3rd, St. John's, Michigan, or January 4th, Seattle, Washington, or January 10th, Sierra Vista, Arizona, or San Bernardino, California, or Denison, Texas, or Marshall, Texas, or Winston-Salem, North Carolina, Italy, Texas, Gentilia, Louisiana. You have all these shootings, and thus far, we see most of these kids have been on some form of antipsychotic or antidepressant medication. Not once will the media discuss this. Why?
Well, that's their sponsors. Let's take a station break and go to the advertisement, and some pharmaceutical company is going to be affected adversely by this negative. They even hid they sealed the records at that Virginia Tech shooting. We still don't know, as far as I know, we still don't know if that kid was on antidepressants, but he had been seen by psychiatrists and had been treated, but we don't know what his blood levels were and so forth. So I don't doubt that there has got to be a role of some of these drugs, or, I mean, let's face it, lead levels can get so high, can have such a neurotoxic effect that they can cause this kind of behavior too. So we know that it's a neurotoxic effect of medication at the very least, or some combination of neurotoxic effects, nutritional deficiency, and so forth, that is causing this. The executive function simply gets shut down. It isn't there.
I'm going to quote a paragraph from Jerome Corsi's Psychiatric Meds Linked to 90% of School Shootings, and this was an excerpt from Psychiatric Drugs Likely Cause of Lanza's Extreme Violence, and it says some 90% of school shootings over more than a decade have been linked to a widely prescribed type of antidepressant called selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or SSRIs, according to British psychiatrist Dr. David Healy. And then it goes on to talk about all these are happening, and yet no one is investigating. The government, local, state, federal. And also, we have a lot of reporters, investigative journalists with outstanding backgrounds. They're very intelligent. They're very well read. They have capacity to resource anything with the companies they work with. And yet not one single orthodox mainstream person has gone after this connection. And right. You just said it was possibly because of the advertisers. What does that tell you about the integrity of a journalist?
Well, that's always a question. But big media, I mean, they want to keep their job. They're told by their bosses what they've got to do investigations on and what they better not touch. So it's, they just want to keep their jobs.
What happens when you discuss this with your colleagues?
It's
my guest.
Studies that combine all the other studies and look for the overall trends, they don't see that SSRIs really have much effect. There is very little outcome proof that they work at all, except for the most severe types of depression. So when they combine, all the studies into one big study and look at the overall trends, they really don't work. And so it's been a massive publicity campaign that and doctors know this too. They see that it's not working, and they say they've been fed a whole bill of goods. It just doesn't work, and patients see that they don't work. But the placebo, when you compare it to placebo, the placebo effect can be up to 20%, and then the enhanced placebo effect, if the medications cause side effects, dry mouth, dizziness, and whatever, there's an enhanced placebo effect up to 40% that the person believes it must be working because it's causing side effects. And when you look at these studies, they simply don't offer much advantage over placebo. So not only are they causing terrible withdrawal symptoms, not only are they releasing the tendency of violence, they also are a very, very poor treatment for depression.
I read a major study that the placebo had equal effect as Prozac, so the placebo is just a sugar pill, and therefore if you were going to take something that didn't work, take a sugar pill, because at least you're not going to end up with brain dysfunction as you would otherwise. I'm just very concerned that even the Las Vegas shooter now is alleged to have had, while he was doing the shooting, was on a psych med, and
yeah,
none of this information gets out.
And it's unclear, and it's that we don't know how much they're going to hide it. But it looked like a benzodiazepine. But if it was Valium, they said, well, he was on Valium the day before. Well, Valium has a very long half-life. If he was taking Valium the day before, he would be on it for several days because it has a very, very long half-life.
Dr. Charles Gann, thank you for your good work and coming on today and letting us know that before we rush to judgment, we should have more context and a deeper understanding.
People need to look at the
hard
facts, So thank you very much for having me on.
All the best. I'm Gary Null. We're out of time. I want to thank you all for listening. I look forward to sharing more on our next program. Have a nice day.